Listen to what the president told NBC. It is helping to raise some eyebrows.
And in fact, when I decided to just do it, I said to myself, I said, you know, this Russia thing with Trump and Russia is a made-up story. It's an excuse by the Democrats for having lost an election that they should have won. And the reason they should have won it is the Electoral College is almost impossible for a Republican to win. Very hard, because you start off at such a disadvantage. So everybody was thinking they should have won the election. This was an excuse for having lost an election.
All right, so the legal question becomes, was this an attempt to obstruct justice by the president in firing Comey? Let's discuss with two men. You got Mark Tushnet, a professor at Harvard Law School, and Alan Dershowitz, a professor emeritus at Harvard Law School. Harvard on Harvard. So for those of us without that pedigree, let's put up the definition of what obstruction of justice requires in terms of elements. You have that a defendant acted with corrupt intent. So intent is important in this crime. That the defendant wanted to interfere with a pending judicial proceeding. And those proceedings were pending. They were going on actually at that time. That the defendant's actions were likely to affect the judicial proceedings. And lastly, that the defendant knew that these proceedings were pending. So first, on the prosecution side of this, Professor Tushnet, what do you think?
I think at the moment we don't know enough to say that the president had what the statute calls corrupt intent. We'll find out over time more about what he was thinking when he has done what he's done.
So we don't know enough, but it's not out of the realm of possibility. Professor Dershowitz, what do you say?
Well, every civil libertarian should be outraged by the breadth of this statute and that people are thinking of applying it to a president's lawful decision to fire Comey. Think of the implications of that for the rest of us, that anybody could be charged with obstruction of justice for doing something lawful. There is a case, I actually argued it many years ago, where a lawyer was convicted of obstruction of justice for allegedly doing lawful things. In that case, they accused him of filing frivolous appeals and false motions and pleadings. But the obstruction of justice statute is a disaster from a civil liberties point of view, and it's a terrible mistake if you're a liberal and don't like Trump to try to broaden a statute to go after Trump and then was stuck with a precedent that could really diminish the liberty of all Americans.
So the fact that what he did was lawful, he had the lawful right to remove the FBI director under law. Why he did it doesn't matter?
Well, usually the criminal law doesn't probe people's motives. We don't put people's motives on trial. There has to also be an illegal act. Now, there are some cases that say that if the whole scheme was corrupt, you could look at the thing as a totality of circumstances.
How about his acknowledgement that he did press the FBI director by his own admission for a loyalty oath on this matter and an insistence that he was not being investigated?
Good reason for voting against him. Good reason for making him pay a political price. I'm sure that Trump did demand loyalty. He demands loyalty of everybody. I suspect the conversation about whether he was under investigation probably went something like this. Am I under investigation? And the FBI director could say, look, if you were a target, you would have gotten a target letter. So you can surmise from the fact that you haven't gotten a target letter that you're not a target. I've had that kind of conversation with prosecutors.
You know Comey. No. Do you think that he would have been in any way eager to give any kind of offering like that to the president?
Of course not.
That's part of the problem, but it's not a legal problem. So back to you, Professor Tushnet. If we don't know enough, what are your concerns in this situation? Legally, morally, ethically?
Well, what we're dealing with now is a combination of a problem that's a little bit law, but mostly political. Mm-hmm. And the way the political process works is that people draw their inferences from what they see in the press. As more smoke accumulates, people begin to think that there might be a fire there. And as they think that there might be a fire there, pressure will build mm-hmm. on politicians to investigate even more completely. Mm-hmm.
And there's one way the president can put out the fire. He has to appoint somebody better than Comey. Senator Lee came up with a brilliant idea. Merrick Garland.
You like that idea.
Was a superb prosecutor. He was appointed by Democrats. Wow, that would put out all fires for months and months and months. Will the president do that? I doubt it.
What if it became known that the reporting that the firing came after Comey had put in a request for more resources to ramp up the investigation? If there was a connection between not just the timing, but the intention to get rid of Comey after the request, does that change your analysis, Professor Tushman?
I don't think it makes much difference in thinking of a sort of criminal prosecution. But again, we're dealing with something that combines law and politics. And on the politics side, yes, it would make a difference to some politicians that this action, the firing occurred after Comey said he was going to intensify the investigation. I don't think there's much question about
it. So chasing the illegality, you believe, is ill-advised, but it doesn't mean that this wasn't wrong on different levels.
Well, here's the way we'll know whether it was wrong. If, in fact, there was a conversation about resources, and then he appoints somebody who's a crony, and the crony says, oh, we have too many resources, let's cut down the investigation, that would really raise serious questions. I hope he doesn't do that. I hope he appoints somebody of great distinction and not a crony. And I think then we survive a constitutional crisis. Otherwise, we're in one.
Professors, thank you very much for the perspective, as always.